So yes guys, so let's talk about IND AS 16. Which deals with property, plant and equipment. Deals with property, plant and equipment. What does the standard have to do with? Now, these words might sound new to us, property, plant and equipment, but predominantly it is about the fixed assets. We talk about fixed assets when we're talking about IND AS 16. It's just a change in the nomenclature that he has used. Now, this property, plant and equipment, the first thing that you have to understand in the IND AS 16 is the definition of the standard. Now, the definition given in the standard says that IND AS 16 PPE is an tangible asset. It is a tangible asset which is held for, now when you say held for, I'm talking about the uses of that asset, and under the uses of the asset, what he gives is three uses. Let's see what are the three uses for which a property, plant and equipment can be held. A property, plant and equipment can be held for, first purpose is use in process of production. Or provision of services. We will discuss about this in depth. Number two, can be held for rental to others. And number three, can be held for administration purpose. Now, so I'm saying that it is a tangible asset which can be held for, either you can use it in the process of production. Process of production is those assets which are in the factory. So I can use all those factory assets as property, plant and equipment, and they will fall under the ambit of IND AS 16, as well as those assets which are held for providing any particular service. Any service, for example, when you talk about chartered accountant, you can talk about a laptop. About an architect, if you talk about, architect uses a lot of his equipment in making sure that his services are available. All such equipment will also fall under the ambit of IND AS 16. Doctors, for providing their service, will use a lot of surgical equipment, and such surgical equipment will also fall under the ambit of IND AS 16. For the purpose of rental to others, in a problem where you want to derive lease rentals, you want to derive higher rentals or lease rentals, then even such an equipment or such an asset will fall under the definition of IND AS 16. However, we will talk about something called as investment property, which is slightly different from what we discussed as far as your IND AS 16 is concerned. We will discuss about that in a bit. Administration purpose. Now, when we talk about administrative purpose, we have to give a good lengthy discussion about it. Now, administrative purpose, when we say that, we have to understand that such assets have nothing to do with the process of production. That means the economic benefit from such assets cannot be identified clearly. Then how do we say that it is a property, plant and equipment? Now such administrative assets, though they do not derive economic benefit directly, they help the other assets to derive economic benefits to the organization. For example, if I'm talking about a firefighting equipment being installed in a system or a premises, now such premises could have run well efficiently even without the firefighting equipment. But to run the premises, or to basically make sure that the premises is complying to the legal norms, I need to make sure that it is equipped with sufficient firefighting equipment. So such equipment might not be giving me direct economic benefit, but is helping all other assets to derive economic benefit to the enterprise. For example, if you can also take even an MD's equipment, MD's chair, MD's AC, MD's table, all these assets are called as corporate assets. Such corporate assets do not directly contribute towards the production, do not directly provide any economic benefit to the enterprise. But such an asset will derive some economic benefit in combination with other assets. That means without such asset, I cannot derive economic benefit with the other assets. Had the managing director not taken certain decisions regarding the production, I cannot use the production equipment to derive economic benefits. So I need to make sure that even that corporate assets, which can be classified under administrative purpose, should be recognized as per Ind AS 16 as property, plant and equipment. So it is a tangible asset. It can be held for three purposes: use in process of production, or for provision of services, or for rental to others, or any other administrative purpose. And the last condition comes up where he says that it should be in a position where you can use it for a period more than 12 months. Expected to be used. For greater than one accounting period. It is expected to be used for more than an accounting period, then you can classify it as property, plant and equipment. All such assets which classify these definition but are expected to be used or expected to be consumed within one accounting period cannot be classified as property, plant and equipment. If there is an asset which is acquired but is expected to provide only the economic benefit within one accounting period, the entire expenditure will be treated as revenue expense, will be charged to P&L, will not be classified under property, plant and equipment at all. So this is what basic understanding of a definition is. But like I said, there are certain confusing concepts between rental to others when we are talking about. Let's see where we pick those up. We understand something called as exclusions from the standard. Exclusions from scope. The scope of the standard specifically excludes certain assets which should not be covered under Ind AS 16. Now, one such asset will be determined as per Ind AS 105. These are assets classified as held for sale. To be more specific, these are non-current assets which are classified as held for sale. Non-current assets classified as held for sale. Non-current asset includes even the property, plant and equipment. But such asset, if it gets classified under Ind AS 105, non-current assets held for sale, then it cannot be governed as per Ind AS 16 anymore, because the entire recognition and measurement of the asset will be as per Ind AS 105. Even the presentation of such asset as per your Schedule 3 is concerned will significantly undergo a change. Now, very similar to this, we have one more. Ind AS 40. Investment property. What is this investment property? Investment property, in the sense, it includes a land or a building or a part of the building or a combination of both land and building together. I'm talking about can include a land, a building or a part of that building. That means one particular portion or one particular floor of that building or a combination of both land and building together will fall under investment property. But it should be held with a main purpose of deriving rental income. It should be for a purpose of deriving rental income. Now, rental to others was a concept even discussed in definition of Ind AS 16. Here also you're talking about rental income. Then how do I distinguish between Ind AS 40 and Ind AS 16? Remember, the first understanding is Ind AS 40 only talks about land and building. While any other asset, if it is held for the purpose of rental to others, then I will classify it only as per Ind AS 16, not as per Ind AS 40 anymore. That is number one. So that means I can have a plant and machinery, I can have a furniture, I can have a vehicle which is sent out on hire, and all such assets will be classified only as per Ind AS 16. Ind AS 40 will stay out of any other class of assets. Only class of assets which can be included here is only your land and building. Only land and building put up here. Now, that means any land and building, does it fall only under investment property? Absolutely no. There could always be a situation where I have established an enterprise only to ensure that I am providing leases of property to someone else. My purpose of business is that. Then in such case, it becomes an Ind AS 16 building. It will not be classified under Ind AS 40. I'm saying that if the primary purpose of my business is to derive lease rentals from the building or from the land, then in such situation, I should classify my building or a land under Ind AS 16, not as per Ind AS 40. Now, let us discuss further then what comes under Ind AS 40. Let's say I am a business enterprise. I have occupied a particular business premises for a long period of time. I have started owning that premises as well now. However, due to the enormous amount of increase in my staffing of the enterprise, that particular premises is now not sufficient to basically have accommodate all my staff. So I made sure that I moved out of the place and I ensured that I have leased out another place in which I am making sure that my staff is being accommodated. Then what about this particular building which I own, such part of the building, I started leasing it out. Now I did derive lease rentals. Now again question arises, Ind AS 16 or Ind AS 40. It is a building, I have leased it out. So you would say that there's a conflict between Ind AS 16 and 40. I would say no. It is simply investment property. The reason is, the main purpose of the business of this enterprise is not to provide any premise on lease. He has done it because it was anyways an ideal asset. So in such situation, we will say that it is an asset classified under Ind AS 40. However, if I am with a primary motive or my business objective is to provide lease rentals or to derive lease rental from property, I'll classify it under Ind AS 16. That is a distinguishment when we talk about Ind AS 16 and this amount here rental to others. Now, moving further into the next exclusion, is the one discussed under Ind AS 11106, mineral rights. Mineral rights and mineral ores cannot be classified as property, plant and equipment under Ind AS 16. Now this should be dealt specifically as per Ind AS 106, very specific standard, so no inclusions as far as this is concerned. Ind AS 41, which talks primarily about agriculture. All agricultural assets are excluded from the scope of the standard. The reason being, Ind AS 41 specifically deals with that. However, when we talk about this part, that is Ind AS 41, that is agriculture, we'll have to specifically deal with two things. You have to see the conflicting interest between Ind AS 16 and Ind AS 41, because there is a distinguishment between items called as bearer plant and biological assets. What is the difference between a bearer plant and a biological asset, and how do we deal with or how do we classify each such item into each standard is what we have to discuss further. What is a bearer plant? What is a biological asset? Is it excluded or included under Ind AS 16, or is it included and excluded as per Ind AS 41? This is what we'll discuss further now. Yes guys, so let's understand the difference between a bearer plant and a biological asset. Now what is the significant differences between a bearer plant and a biological asset has to be understood, because we need to know which standard actually governs each of them. I will start with the initial word, saying that bearer plant is governed as per Ind AS 16, while a biological asset is basically treated as per Ind AS 41. So I'm saying this bearer plant is as per Ind AS 16, that is property, plant and equipment, while the biological asset should be dealt as per Ind AS 41. How did we distinguish this? Now, first of all, let's understand what a bearer plant is. Then we'll understand why we have classified it as Ind AS 16. Bearer plants are normally cultivated for the production or supply of agricultural produce. they are cultivated for production and supply of agricultural produce. Number two, they are expected to bear the produce. For greater than 12 months, more than one accounting period. Number three, they have a remote likelihood of being sold other than as scrap sale. I'm predominantly using most of the terminologies which is used in the standard, probably because I want you to reproduce the same as far as your exams are concerned. So that is the reason why I'm using a lot of terminology which is related to what is given in IND AS 16. So try to make sure that the terminology is maintained as well. Now, what are we talking about here? It is cultivated for production and supply of agricultural produce. That means the plant by itself is not an agricultural produce. The plant will basically have is being cultivated to derive some agricultural produce which will be sold. Now, for example, when I have a mango tree, the tree by itself is not being sold. It derives a mango which is my agricultural produce and is expected to be used or sold. So in such case, the tree by itself is called as bearer plant. Observe here with what we are saying, expected to bear the produce for more than 12 months is a general phenomena. Because such plants will normally give you produce every season. Seasonal fruits, they keep on coming up. But as such, I have no idea of chopping off the plant and actually making it an agricultural produce. So it is bearing the produce for more than one accounting period. It is gonna give me at least a life of at least 15 to 16 years. I'm gonna get those mango produce. Even your coconut tree has the same case. You actually pluck the coconut out of it, you sell it out, or you make your you use it for any other process of production. But the tree by itself is not being cut. Remote likelihood of being sold other than a scrap sale. That means you have no intention to sell it, but sometimes there could be a scrap sale. That means the plant is no longer being of any use. In such case, you might sell it off, maybe to be used as a wood or something like that for the stem or any other purpose. So when we look at these three criterias are what we can talk about when we say bearer plant. When we use the word bearer plant, then these are the three situations, or these are the three things which can be affiliated to this word bearer plant. And what is this biological asset then? Biological asset, when I talk about, biological assets are, first one, cultivated as agricultural produce. That means the plant itself is an agricultural produce itself. That means it is cultivated not for the supply of agricultural produce, but it is cultivated as an agricultural produce. What you want as an agricultural produce is the plant by itself. Now, what could be such plants which you have right there? You can basically name such plants which are uprooted directly. That means at the time of normally harvesting your potato or some beetroots or these kind of stuff, you have a plant, and such plant, unless or until it is completely plugged out, you don't really get that get the agricultural produce. So they are cultivated as an agricultural produce. Number one. Number two, they yield agricultural produce . This more or less looks like bearer plant, but plus there is more than remote likelihood of being sold. That means, though I have cultivated them for agricultural produce, but I am saying even that plant by itself also I want to sell. The best example that you can take for this is a banana tree. Because each banana tree can only have one produce. That's it. After that, there's no produce that is going to come from a banana tree. So what basically happens, you have initially grown it for the purpose of yielding those bananas, which can be sold as agricultural produce. But at the same time, the entire trunk or the leaves of the banana tree also are chopped off at the end, because they by itself also carry some value. And by leaving it like that, they are not expected to produce for more than 12 months. They are not expected to bear the produce for more than 12 months. Next season will not come for that banana tree. You have to chop it off. That is the reason why we normally call them as biological assets and not as bearer plants. Third one we can talk about is annual crops. Annual crops like rice, wheat, maize, all these are annual crops which have nothing to do with your biological assets, because they by themselves have to be uprooted for yielding the agricultural produce. Without uprooting the entire stem or entire plant by itself, you will not derive the agricultural produce at all. So thus, such annual crops which are one time, they are not expected to bear the produce for more than 12 months, will be classified as biological assets. Bearer plants are covered under Ind AS 16, presented as property, plant and equipment, while biological assets are excluded from the scope of Ind AS 16 and they are specifically included under a standard Ind AS 41 which deals with agriculture. Very, very important to understand the significant differences between both, especially when you go to a plantation industry. When you actually look into the plantation industry, you have a lot of significance in differentiating or distinguishing between a bearer plant and a biological asset. Let's see further into the recognition criteria of a property, plant and equipment. When we want to understand this recognition criteria, we have to understand what are the conditions which are necessary for recognizing an asset or a tangible asset as a property, plant and equipment. When an expenditure is incurred, first recognition criteria that you have to understand to recognize any expenditure as a capital expenditure to be capitalized as property, plant and equipment, the first criteria is that probable future economic benefits arise from use of asset. This is the first recognition criteria. Second one, it should be within the control of enterprise. Third one, the cost should be reliably measured. Let's understand each one independently. First, we are talking about probable future economic benefits. Probable. You need not quantify what is the amount of economic benefit and when are you going to receive such economic benefit need not be established. He just used the word probable. So you need not establish what is the time and the amount of economic benefit that would arise from it. So you need not quantify that. But you are saying that it should be probable to derive some economic benefits. When I use the word economic benefit, I mean to say either it should be an increase in revenue or a decrease in cost or an ease of use. This is your recognition criteria. So I would say that economic benefit should be probable. So I'm saying that you need not establish what is the probability of economic benefit, or you need not establish the timing or the amount of economic benefits. So I'm saying that no certainty of amount or timing of benefit, you need not establish this. I would still say that it is probable. So it should arise from the use of the asset. That is what we are talking about here. And we are saying that it should be within the control of enterprise. When I say within the control, that means that the entity is capable of restricting or granting access . If I am capable of restricting and granting access to a particular asset, then I would say that there is control being exercised. Now, just to cite, okay, let's say we are talking about a telecom operator, and let's say something like BSNL. I'll be more specific on this. In the case of BSNL, when we have actually gone for the fixed assets verification, one thing that we have understood from their fixed asset register, that there were a lot of such assets which have been capitalized, which shouldn't have been capitalized. Now, how did I know that it shouldn't have been capitalized? With a simple reason that such assets included certain cables and switching equipment which were laid on the road. Now, the cables and switching equipment which are running across the road, what control does the enterprise even exercise on that? You should be having a capacity, or you should be having, you have a capability of restricting access or granting access to the asset. Now, I cannot restrict access to that particular asset, neither I can grant access to that asset. It is there on the road. General public can definitely have an access to that. There could be a cable cut. Had there been no been cable cuts, you will not see that your telephone is dead or your telephone is not operating. Now, these situations arise because insufficient control was exercised by the entity. When an asset cannot be exercised, when a control cannot be exercised over an asset, then such asset cannot be recognized. I have a car, and how do I actually have a car control over the car? I have a key. If I give a key to someone, then obviously I'm granting access to him. If I'm locking the car and I'm putting it in my pocket, I'm restricting access to that. Now, that is how I can have a physical control or physical access control over the asset. The control objective is very, very important. Moving further, the cost should be reliably measured. Now, this reliable measurement of cost is normally given under cost concepts. This is measurement of cost concept, which is in depth dealt in the standard. Again, under cost, we have initial cost and subsequent cost. We will start seeing them later part of the standard. As of now, just remember that we will discuss about this reliable measurement of cost at a later point of time. Now, moving further, we have a very specific asset called as land and building. Now, when we talk about this land and building, the peculiar concept is most of the enterprises that we see have recognized an asset called as land and building by itself. But according to the standard says you cannot classify an asset as land and building. You will have to make sure that you are identifying or distinguishing the land and the building portion separately. Now, why did they say that? In a simpler sense, to understand in a logical way, that building is a depreciable asset while land is not. So if I combine both the asset together and represent it, it would be difficult for me to establish how much is the depreciable component over. So that is why we say that though the land and building have always been acquired on a combination basis, because when I buy a building, there is no possibility for me to actually recognize only the building as an asset. There is an undivided portion of land which is also acquired along with it. Such undivided portion of land has to be recognized separately. Now, how do we show that? Now, when he says land and building should be recognized separately, what he says is they should always be determined with respect to the fair value. Recognized as separate assets. But like I said, sometimes it is not possible because you have acquired it on a combination. I don't know what is the value of land separately, what is the value of building separately. In such instances, what we do is the fair value of building is given like this. Fair value of building is equal to the fair value of land and building. This is nothing but the consideration which I paid, which should be reduced by minus fair value of land. And you can depreciate them separately, or I would depreciate the building part and I would recognize the land separately as a non-depreciable asset. This way, the standard prescribes saying that a land and a building should always be recognized separately. You cannot recognize them on a combination basis. There is no account head called as land and building. Land should be recognized separately, building should be recognized separately. So ensure that you're recognizing two assets whenever you have acquired a land and building. When you cannot identify, then take the consolidated price that you have paid and reduce it with the amount of fair value of the building, the fair value of the land. Automatically, the residual figure is called as fair value of building, which becomes a depreciable asset per se. Now, this is our basic concept which revolves around the recognition criteria. Now, there was a question which was very predominantly asked is, let's say I've acquired 10 chairs or I've acquired about 100 ceiling fans. Now, those 100 ceiling fans which are established, which are being purchased and have been fitted into the premises, if I look at the materiality being concept of being introduced, the question arises, should I treat each such chair or each such fan as a separate asset? Or should I treat the combination of everything or entire 100 units or 10 units put together as one single unit? How do I recognize that particular asset? Whenever this question has come up, now the question is being answered saying that this is called as unit of measurement. Now he says unit of measurement, when we talk about, he says that unit of measurement should be based on the materiality. If the individual asset is not material, then a combination of all those assets put together will be considered as one single asset. But if in case each asset, even though you bought it in multiple units, each one is material enough, then ensure that you are recognizing each asset separately. You have to recognize each chair separately or each, you know, ceiling fan separately if it is material. If it is not material, then the combination of all chairs put together will be recognized as one single asset, and all the ceiling span together will be considered as one single asset in the books of our in the books of accounts. That is a very significant recognition criteria paragraph which we have to understand, which is called as unit of measurement. So unit of measurement should always be based on the materiality concept. Clear? Yes, guys. So let's start discussing about measurement of cost. Your cost measurement is a very significant concept as far as your Ind AS 16 is concerned. Has a lot of significance as well, because a lot of different concepts are being touched about when we discuss about this measurement of cost. Let's take up how many different types of measurements of cost did he actually emphasize upon. The standard talks about the first part being separate acquisition. A separate acquisition way of identifying the cost of the assets. So when you have acquired the asset separately over a significant acquisition, how do we identify or determine the cost? Number two, self-constructed assets. Determination of cost when the asset is constructed by the enterprise itself. Third one, multiple assets acquired in single transaction. This is one more. Where I am not doing slump sale, but I am doing a slump purchase. That means I paid one consideration for which I have received multiple assets. A, B, C put together, I have bought three assets at a particular price. How do I allocate the cost to each asset? Acquisition through through government grants. We'll have to see it in light of IND AS 20, which deals with government grants. In combination with that, we'll discuss about this. And the last one is exchange of assets. This exchange of assets, in other words, is also called as non-monetary consideration. I paid consideration, but it is not in terms of money. I'll call it as non-monetary consideration. These are the five concepts of determination of cost. Either you have to determine the cost for a separate acquisition when you have acquired each asset separately, multiple assets put together in a single transaction, or you have constructed the asset by yourself, then how you determine the cost. Acquisition through government grants, that means you have got a government grant with which you have bought an asset, then what is the recognition basis. And exchange of assets, you have given up one asset, instead you have acquired one more asset. So this is non-monetary consideration for the asset. Now these are multiple ways in which I can identify the cost, or multiple different cases in which I have to identify the measurement of cost. Now we'll discuss about each one in depth, but before that, we have a very critical concept to examine, which is introduced only by the IND AS, is payment in deferred credit terms. Payments made in deferred credit terms. Now, what is this deferred credit terms? Deferred credit terms, in simple essence, mean I've acquired an asset where normally the credit term should have been about 60 days, but instead now I have been offered by the supplier a credit of more than that. Let's say, for example, if the normal credit is 60 days, but you have purchased the asset, X and Y have made a transaction like this. X will transfer the asset, Y will pay the consideration, but this consideration which is paid has been offered at 120 days credit. Now when I have this situation which is arising, how do I identify the value of the asset on deferred credit terms? In this situation, you have to understand that your consideration is not exactly the value of the asset. What we are saying is the transaction price, in this case, the price at which you have entered into the transaction, is not exactly equal to the fair value of the asset. Now, why did I come up with this? Why did I make this statement, first of all, that it is not equal to the fair value of the asset? Reason why I made this statement is because the person who has supplied the asset to you would have made the transaction price considering the credit terms, which is extended beyond the normal credit terms. When it is extended beyond normal credit terms and you are trying to make an arrangement like this, you have to understand that there is an inherent amount of credit period. Inherent cost of deferred credit. So in this case, the cost of asset is equal to the price of asset under normal credit terms . Now, when I say that the cost of the asset should be recognized at a price at which the supplier would have supplied the good at, or supplied the asset at, normal credit terms, but you are saying that the transaction price is not the same. So I'll go up to say that the transaction price minus the amount of cost of asset. The asset is recognized at a particular cost, will be called as finance charges. Now this finance charges here
should be accounted as per IND AS 23.
Your finance charges should be identified as per IND AS 23. So what are we trying to say? Whenever we have a credit term which is deferred beyond normal credit terms, the transaction price, the price at which you have agreed to purchase the asset, is not equal to the fair value of the asset. So I'm saying that there is an inherent nature of deferred credit which would result in finance charges. So I'm saying that the asset will be recognized only to the extent of the price at which the asset would have been transacted with normal credit terms. The difference between the transaction price and your cost of asset, whatever is there, we will treat it as finance charges and treat it as per IND AS 23. So this is a significant difference which has come up. And one thing which I wanted to remind you people is that this particular para, payment which is extended for deferred credit terms, is very similar, because you have the same paragraph coming up in IND AS 2, IND AS 38, and IND AS 40. This paragraph will again appear as it is in other standards. 2 will be talking about inventory, 38 talking about intangible assets, and 40 will be talking about your investment property. So these three standards also have a similar definition or similar explanation regarding any asset purchased on deferred credit terms. Now this is a very important understanding, guys. Please make sure that you are noted about this and make sure that there's a practical application which does go into each and every paragraph which is being discussed under IND AS 16. Like we have seen that there are different ways of measuring the cost, we'll have to first look at separate acquisition. In this concept of separate acquisition, where an asset is acquired separately, we'll have to first see how to identify the cost of this particular asset which is separately acquired. For us to understand the separate acquisition, I'll split the separate acquisition cost components into three parts. Separate acquisition has components of cost the cost which can be included in it. The first one will be purchase price or purchase cost. This is the first one. The second one is other direct cost. While the third one talks about dismantling removal and site restoration cost. These are the three components of cost that can be included when an asset is separately acquired. Now, what does each component actually include? Let's break it up and let's see. When we are talking about purchase cost, the cost of purchase includes purchase price, which should be reduced by the amount of trade discount which is allowed by the supplier at the time of purchase, not the cash discount. The trade discount is what I'm talking about. That is a discount which is allowed at the time of purchase, should be added by all non-refundable taxes. What is non-refundable tax and what is a refundable tax? Refundable taxes are those taxes for which input tax credit is available. When I talk about refundable taxes, are those where input tax credit is available. Non-refundable taxes means, other than that, if an input tax credit is not available, then I'll call it as a non-refundable tax. Now, if I cannot avail the input tax credit in such situation, I'll call it as a non-refundable tax. I'll add it to the cost of purchase. So purchase price, the price at which you have negotiated to buy the particular good, reduced by the amount of trade discounts which is allowed by the supplier, added by the amount of non-refundable taxes, if any. And this will be called as cost of purchase. Then what is this other direct cost? Other direct cost includes cost incurred to bring the asset to locate to a location and condition in which it is intended to be operated by the management. Understand what I am putting across here. Any cost incurred to bring the asset to its location and condition in which the management is intending to operate such asset. Now, if you basically understand what I'm trying to include here is, in the first one where I was talking about the purchase price or the cost of purchase, I've restricted myself to only the transaction up to the purchase point. That's it. That means at the supplier's premises, I've stopped it. But subsequent to that, there is an amount of expenditure which is incurred. Understand what I'm putting across, location and condition. Now, where is the particular good or where is the particular asset now? At the supplier's place. Now, what is the location in which you intend to use it? I intend to use it in my premises. So that means such location cost includes transportation. Should also include transit insurance. Any insurance which is taken on transportation should also be included. This is the first inclusion which I am talking about. After you have got the good into your godown, there is a cost which is incurred for loading and unloading. Along with this, I'm talking about two points till now. Transportation, loading, unloading. Along with that, once you unload the good, there is a, unload the asset. The first thing that you have to do is place the asset at that particular point and make sure that it is being installed. Installation. Not enough. Not enough, guys. Just because the asset is installed doesn't mean that the asset is ready for its use. Condition in which you intend to use it. So that means I am basically trying to say that it is installed, but I don't know whether it is in a condition where I want to operate it or I intend to operate it. So how do you know whether it is in a condition where you want to operate it or not? You have to first do a trial run. Do a trial run. This trial run is called as commissioning. The technical term is commissioning, guys. In colloquial language, we call it as trial run cost. So such cost will be included as far as your other direct cost is gone. Once you get a trial run and that trial run basically proves to you a positive result, you will say that that is over. My direct cost is completed. Now this is what we are trying to put across as far as your other direct cost is concerned. All such costs incurred to bring the asset to its current location and condition in which it is intended to be used by management. Now, let's see this dismantling cost. Dismantling and site restoration cost, this is a very new concept which has been introduced out here. Why has this even come up? Now, normally, let's say an asset has been installed in such a way that it requires a significant dismantling cost. Now, what happens? I've used the asset, I've capitalized the asset, I've used the asset for about 10 years period. Now, the age of the asset is already over. Now, what am I supposed to do? This asset has to be dismantled and removed and sold off or disposed of, and then a new asset has to be installed. Now understand, there is a significant cost element which will be incurred at that point of time. I am referring to such cost. Had I not capitalized the dismantling cost at the time of acquisition of the asset, what will happen? The asset is completely depreciated. Such dismantling cost will occur actually at the end of the useful life, that let's say 10 years. At the end of the 10 years, I've incurred this cost, and such cost which I have basically incurred will directly be charged into your P&L. Now that could be a significant cost. If I charge it directly to the P&L, my P&L gets adversely affected when such event actually occurs. So to minimize the impact of such a particular item, what we are trying to do is, we will capitalize that along with the cost, and we will try to make sure that it is allocated to P&L in the form of depreciation over the useful life. When you add it to the cost of the asset, what is happening? The cost of the asset has increased. When your cost of the asset has increased, automatically the depreciation which will be charged to the P&L each year is also increased. Now such cost is allocated over the useful life, even though it is expected to be incurred only at the end of its useful life of the asset. Now this is the reason for dismantling cost. The second logical explanation which I can give you why I am adding a dismantling cost is because of the constructive obligation defined under Ind AS 37. By installing that asset over there in my factory premises, I have automatically assumed a liability. What liability did you assume? A liability of incurring a future expenditure at the time when I want to dismantle that particular asset. Had I not installed that asset, I wouldn't have been incurring such dismantling cost. But since I have installed that asset, I have taken up a new liability on my head, that is to actually incur the cost for dismantling of the asset at the end of its useful life. So by going around with Ind AS 37, we have to say that such dismantling cost is a provision which is required as per Ind AS 37, saying that it is a constructive obligation. Constructive obligation. And this is defined under Ind AS 37. And what is this cost? This is basically a provision that we are maintaining. So I would say then, this is an estimated future cost . Since it is estimated future cost, we have to recognize a provision to that extent. But this provision which you have recognized out here, since it is relating to a future cost, we'll have to make sure that it is discounted to present value. Over the useful life or the estimated useful life of asset. So we are saying that we will recognize a provision for the estimated future cost. When will you incur? At the end of its useful life. So I am making an estimate today, and I am discounting that estimate to its present value, and I am adding it to the cost of the asset. So what am I doing? I'm increasing the cost of the asset. At the same time, a liability is being created to the extent of the amount of provision. And this provision, I will make sure that it will be interest catch up happens over this provision, and automatically it becomes equal to the estimated amount at the end of the useful life. This is in essence what we can include as far as separate acquisition is concerned. Now this part, which I'm talking about, the trial run cost and the commissioning cost, will have a certain specific explanation that we have to go under. Now that we will see along with self-generated assets. In self-generated assets also there is a trial run cost which we will incur, but we'll have a further explanation to add upon on what is this trial run cost and when do I capitalize that item. Now this is predominantly a significant separate acquisition of an asset, and how to measure the cost in such event. So yes guys, let's understand what are self-generated assets and how do I recognize the cost of a self-generated asset. I'm talking about cost concept, continuing with the previous one. but I'm talking about a new concept that is self-generated asset within identification of cost or determination of cost. How do I determine the cost for a self-generated asset? Now, when we are trying to determine the cost of a self-generated asset, the inclusions in the cost could basically be the materials consumed in the process, number two, labor wages, and salaries to staff which is involved in this process. Along with that, we can also have professional fees which is involved in creating that particular asset. Some architect I might have taken, I might have taken a structural engineer's opinion over that. Along with that, we can also have an amount of legal fees which is incurred. In registration, all other direct cost which is incurred in establishing that self-generated asset or generating that asset also includes trial run cost. Without a trial run, you will never know whether the asset is giving a positive results or no. Along with that, in a self-generated asset, I'll also have to include estimated cost of dismantling, removal, and site restoration. These are certain costs which I can include in a self-generated asset. Let's say, for example, I wanted a factory premises which is my asset. I bought a piece of land and I want to create or I want to generate that particular asset of building. I have taken up that activity of construction of my factory premises, and in such process I have incurred some material, be it steel, be it cement, be it any other equipment which I have incurred, labor wages, the wages which are involved in constructing that particular building, professional fees involved, be it the architect or structural engineer whose opinions are really important for me to construct that particular asset, legal fees which is incurred in registration of that particular asset. You have to claim the ownership of that particular asset, there is a legal fee which is incurred. Other direct costs, there could be hundreds of direct costs which can be incurred. There could be even a security staff salary who is actually guarding your particular asset. So even that cost could be incurred over there. And then I have a trial run. I make a trial run before I would say that, this asset is complete. Now, whenever we were talking about trial run, even in the case of separate acquisition, I told you we have a good explanation or good discussion that goes around trial run cost. When I'm talking about trial run, when a trial run happens, a trial run can result in two ways. Either it results in a failure or it results in success. If there is success, we won't talk much. But if the trial run has resulted in a failure, then that is something that we have to discuss about. If a trial run results in a failure, then this cost is not eligible to be capitalized, because what do you do after that? You again do the trial run after the necessary changes to the asset. Now, after such necessary changes and you have actually tried to fix it up and then created the trial run, then that cost will result in a success. Whenever it results in success, this is eligible to be capitalized. So this is a trial run discussion which I wanted to make. I have installed a particular asset, or I have generated a particular asset. I put some input to that particular asset and I wanted to check whether the output is correct or not. I did the input, but the output is not appropriate. What do you say? The trial run has failed. So what do? I do necessary changes to the asset and I make sure that I do the trial run again. Such trial run or commissioning, once it becomes successful, only the successful cost should be capitalized to the asset. Whenever it results in a failure, make sure that you are charging it to P&L itself. This will be charged to P&L. While this is eligible to be capitalized. This is regarding the trial run cost which I was talking about. Now comes a very, very important concept that if these are inclusions, then there are situations where you are talking about exclusions as well. Exclusions, I'm talking about self-generated asset. What are the exclusions? Cost for launching a new product or a service. I've incurred certain cost in launching a new product or a service. Such cost will not be included as far as your cost of self-generated assets is concerned. Similarly, cost of introducing a new facility I have a particular asset and it is being used for a particular purpose. If I have enhanced it for the new facility to be created, I will not capitalize such cost. Cost for venturing into a new market. If you venture into a new market, such cost is not eligible to be capitalized. Significant cost goes into entering into a new market, guys. At the same time, selling and distribution cost is one more. Selling and distribution cost is not a direct cost to be included. In the same way, we have administration expenses or administration cost. Even the administration cost is not eligible to be capitalized to the cost of a self-generated asset. Now these are something where I call it as exclusions from the cost of asset. These can never be included into the cost of an asset. Now I'm talking about self-generated assets inclusion. I explained about the trial run. Now I'm talking about the exclusion, saying that if you introduce a new product, the cost of introducing a new product is not capitalized. It should be charged. Yes, guys. So let's continue with the measurement of cost. So now we will be taking up multiple assets acquired in single transaction. Multiple assets are acquired in a single transaction. Now, what is this concept which I am referring to? I am referring to a concept where I have assets like this. Asset A1, asset A2, asset A3. All three were acquired with the help of a consolidated price. Now, from this consolidated price, I will have to separate and identify the cost of each asset A1, A2 and A3 separately. How do I identify the cost of each asset separately is what we discuss in this concept of multiple assets acquired in a single transaction. A single consolidated price is paid for multiple assets. In such case, how do I recognize the value of each asset or the cost of each asset? Now remember, guys, this allocation which happens for the consolidated price among the assets, this should be in the proportion of the fair value of assets. So that means I'm using the ratio A1 is to A2 is to A3. I'm using this ratio and allocating the consolidated price to each of such assets. Now this is basically your multiple assets which are acquired in a single transaction. However, there's some critical aspects which can occur when we're talking about this allocation of price. When we have that the sum of all the fair values of assets, if it is exceeding the consolidated price, this is one situation which might arise. In the same way, I can also have another situation where I say that the sum of all the fair values of individual assets is less than the amount of consolidated price. I'm referring to two situations which are arising here. The first one where I'm saying that the sum of all the fair values of individual assets is greater than the amount of consolidated price. When such a situation arises, where sum of fair values is less than consolidated price, then use the proportion of fair values. That means I'll go with the same logic of A1 is to A2 is to A3. But if I'm coming up with this one where the sum of all the fair values is less than the amount of consolidated price, that means A1 plus A2 plus A3 put together is coming to a fair value cost of about 100, but I paid a consideration of 120. Why did I pay the 20 rupees excess when I could have acquired A1, A2 and A3 separately? The 20 rupees excess is not because of the asset, but because of the synergy effect which is coming out of the asset. Such synergy effect we normally refer to in accounting terms as goodwill. So what we say is, in this case, recognize each asset at their fair values, but however there is certain portion of consolidated price which is still pending. The balance consideration after allocation at fair values should be referred to as goodwill. The balance of consideration after allocating to the fair values, if I am recognizing every asset at fair value, will be referred to as goodwill. Now this is basically the entire concept which revolves around your consolidated price or a single transaction purchase of multiple assets. So yes guys, let's continue in recognition of cost itself now. So we are talking about exchange of assets. When there is an exchange of assets, we have also named this as non-monetary consideration. How do I recognize an asset if it is acquired through non-monetary consideration? Consideration not paid in the form of cash, but it is one asset given up for the other. Now this I'm talking about, I have an asset A1 and I have given it up with a supplier, and instead the supplier has instead given me something else, that is A2, second asset. Normal situation guys, so many exchange policies are right now revolving around in the market. So I'm talking about one such scheme where the supplier is taking back one asset while he's actually giving me another asset instead. Now under this exchange scheme, I call this as non-monetary consideration because I did not pay in cash, but instead I paid an asset for that purpose. How do I recognize it? Remember, the asset acquired should be recognized. Always at fair value. Simple measurement scheme which I am talking about. The asset which is acquired should always be measured at its fair value. However, there's a small exception given here. Unless, number one, transaction lacks commercial substance. Now, what is this transaction lacking commercial substance? Transaction lacks commercial substance means I have exchanged an asset with my friend. I have given my car to him and I have taken his car over. Now, there is no commercial substance. Since there is a relationship of a friend which we have exchanged our cars. So, you might say that there is an exchange of asset which happened here, but the transaction by nature lacks a commercial substance, and unless and until there is a commercial substance to a particular transaction, it cannot be recorded at all. Similarly, I have one more exception. When the fair value cannot be reliably measured. When the fair value of an asset cannot be reliably measured, then I cannot take up this recognition of asset at fair value. When the fair value itself can't be measured, how will you recognize an asset at its fair value? That is why what he says here is, whenever this situation appears, then always recognize the asset acquired at the carrying cost. Carrying cost is nothing but book value of asset given up. Carrying cost is nothing but the book value of the asset given up. So make sure that you are recognizing the asset at its carrying cost of asset given up itself. So you don't recognize the new asset. You will make sure that the cost, carrying cost of the new, of the old asset which was given up, will continue to be the cost of the new asset. The only difference in the presentation would be the earlier asset, you must have shown it as cost less accumulated depreciation. Here it cannot be the situation. So cost minus accumulated depreciation, whatever is the value, that should be considered as the original cost of the newly acquired asset. This is one such concept that we'll be talking about. Now, this is something we will have to discuss about exchange of assets, and a similar paragraph has also been laid down in IND AS 38 and 40. Similar paragraph of exchange of assets is also there in IND AS 38 as well as IND AS 40. Now, this is exchange of assets, always recognized at fair value. Unless the transaction itself lacks a commercial substance, then I will not record the transaction at all. Number two, if the fair value cannot be determined, then make sure that you are measuring it at carrying cost of the asset given up. First case, I will not record the transaction. Second case, I will record it, but I will record it at the carrying cost of asset which has been given up. Now, moving forward, the next one will be acquisition through government grant. Now, we'll have to understand this in light of IND AS 20, that is regarding government grants. Now, what is the treatment or the measurement of cost when the acquisition has happened through a government grant? When we're talking of government grant, then we have to make sure that we are recognizing always the asset at book fair value itself. There's no change. Recognize the asset at fair value. This is compulsory. But the difference happens here. When you have recognized it at fair value, then what about the government grant portion? Then the government grant should be recognized as deferred government grant account. this amount of deferred government grant should be credited to P&L over the period for which the conditions are necessary to be satisfied. Conditions attached are necessary to be satisfied. Now, if you have observed very carefully with the text which I have written here, I am giving the treatment by crediting the amount of government grant to P&L, but I am not giving it right at the year in which I have received the grant. I am crediting it over the period for which the conditions attached to the grant are satisfied. The assumption which the standard has taken in this case is that every government grant will always have certain conditions which the enterprise has to fulfill to be eligible for such government grant. That is the underlying crux and concept of Ind AS 20. Ind AS 20 always revolves around the logic that every government grant has certain conditions which are attached to them, and unless the conditions are satisfied, the government grant will not be eligible to the enterprise. Now, what we are trying to say is there could always be a situation where such conditions are not applicable. Probably in India, majority of the government grants are by birth. Like you are a woman, then there is a grant. You are from a backward caste, then there is a particular grant which is being provided to us. You are underprivileged, then you are definitely eligible to a grant. Now, this way we have a different scheme. There is no condition which is necessary to be satisfied over a period of years. Now, in such cases, the entire amount of the government grant, how it is a treatment, has not been specified. In such case, attaching to the standard, the number of years for which the condition has to be satisfied, the condition is not there, so then we will credit the entire deferred government grant to P&L directly. Got it? But the asset should always be recognized at its fair value only. This is the underlying concept of Ind AS 20 and will be adopted even when we are talking about Ind AS 16. We will refer to the same paragraph in a similar manner when we are referring to Ind AS 20 in a much more detailed manner of how it has actually arisen. Got it? So two things, exchange of assets and government grant, and both the cases I have termed it as fair value. Both cases I am terming it as fair value for recognition of asset. What we are going to discuss now is a very, very important concept called as component base of accounting. Or component basis of recognition. So when you are basically looking at recognition of a fixed asset or your property, plant and equipment, as the name Ind AS 16 promotes, in this component basis of recognition, we are always insisted that an asset should be identified for its major components. I'm naming this as C1, C2, C3. And I call them as major components. And such major components have to be identified with respect to each asset. Now, this is not new as far as Ind AS 16 is concerned, because the same thing was recommended as per AS 10. He's emphasizing here, because earlier it was a recommendation, now it becomes a compulsion, not just as per the Ind AS 16, but also as per your Companies Act 2013, which has always insisted on representing your assets with their major components to be identified and presented separately. So when I recognize each asset, I will have to ensure that each separate component is identified and recognized separately. Now, why is this being even promoted? Now, this in your Companies Act is given under Schedule 2 of depreciation, saying that the componentized approach has to be followed for recognition of assets. The reason is each separate component of an asset can have a distinguishable life and a distinguishable scrap value. Now, for example, if I'm talking about a car, I'm talking about a more identifiable asset, okay? Because we see the car almost every day. So if I talk about a car, what do you actually observe as the major components? There is a tire, there's a gear which is up there, there's a body which is completely of steel which is up there. Now, multiple items or multiple components basically form one particular asset called as a car. Now, my logic of identifying them as each individual component is because I would say that my useful life of the car is 5 years, but during the period of 5 years, my tires will not survive. I will have to change the tires on a periodic basis based on the number of kilometers run. So my depreciation pattern for the tire is based on the kilometers, but for the car, my useful life is based on the number of years which I want to use. So if you basically understand that depreciation pattern is different, the recognition pattern is different, that is the reason why replacement pattern is also different. So this requires a component basis of recognition. Now, when we are going for a component basis of recognition, why is it even emphasized so much? Is it just because of depreciation that he has emphasized so much? Absolutely no. Because the standard talks about something called as subsequent cost. Subsequent cost of property, plant and equipment. When we talk about the subsequent cost on property, plant and equipment, earlier we were saying that if it enhances the cost of the value of an asset, then it will be capitalized to the asset, otherwise I will treat it as revenue expenditure. But here we are trying to say that in the subsequent cost, if it is a regular upkeep of asset, if it is required, then I will charge it to P&L. I need such subsequent cost for regular upkeep of my property, plant and equipment. I'll charge it off to P&L. We'll not talk about that. But if it is infrequent replacement of a part of PPE, then we have to make sure that we capitalize the replacement cost. And what is this infrequent replacement which I'm talking about, and why do I even capitalize that? So no enhancement of asset, nothing. We're just talking about if it is a regular upkeep, you need a particular cost to be incurred, you charge it off to P&L. But if it is irregular and we are talking about infrequent items where there is a replacement of a component, then we'll capitalize it. Now let's see what we are talking about. Let's say for suppose an asset of a PPE was having a cost of 100. I've split this into three parts. I'm identifying three major components for this: A, B and C. Since you said component of basis of accounting is necessary, so I'm recognizing each component separately, and I've said this component has a value of about 45, this has a value of about 25, and this has a residual value out of 100. I think we are already there with 70, so this needs about 30. If I say the useful life is given like this, this will be available for me for 9 years, this for about 5 years, while this is only available for 3 years. If I want to depreciate it per annum, then I will require rupee 5 per annum, then 5 per annum, while this depreciation will be 10 per annum. As something like this. Let's say if suppose we have gone for a replacement of a component. Now, which component do you want to replace? Let's say we are somewhere at end of year 2. By the end of year 2, I'm talking about, my A, B and C will look something like this. My A, which had a cost of 45, was depreciated by 5 every year, then I've depreciated 10 rupees for 2 years. I'm left out with a cost of about 35 over here. The one which I'm talking about in B, 25, I've depreciated it by 10. Let's say I'm still left out with the carrying cost of 15. C, which was 30, I've already depreciated it by 20 over 2 years period. I'm left out with 10. Let's say at the end of the second year, I have a problem with this component B. and this component B has been replaced, let's say at the end of year 2 it is replaced, and the rupee value of the replacement is, let's say, about 40 rupees. I have replaced this component by paying about 40 rupees. Then in such situation, whenever I have this, the treatment goes something like this. The carrying cost of replaced component will be charged to P&L while the replacement cost is capitalized to the cost of the asset. Observe what we are doing in this case. This is the treatment which I am proposing as per componentized approach, and I am saying that the carrying cost of the replaced component, what is the carrying cost of the replaced component? 15 is charged to P&L, and the replacement cost, 40 rupees, will be capitalized to the cost of the asset. So my revised PPE will look something like this. A, B and C. A has a carrying cost of 35. B now has a carrying cost of 40. C has a carrying cost of 10. This is what has changed. Had I been following the earlier approach, then what would have happened? This is only replacement of the component. So there is nothing else which will happen. Charge this 40 to P&L and carry over the asset at the same consolidated value of whatever you have here, about 60. But now you check the value, what you have here, you have a value of about 85 coming up instead of that 60. So the value of the asset has increased because of this. Because understand, by logical reason, let's say I have replaced the tires of my car, the value of the car without replacement of the tires and after replacement of the tire is definitely yes, definitely greater. But one thing what I can say is there is no enhancement in the use. But had I not replaced the tire, I wouldn't have been in a position to utilize the value of that particular asset. That is the reason why we are going for a componentized approach, and here that 15 rupees should be charged to P&L. This is what is emphasized as per component basis of recognition. Very, very, very important concept, guys. Understand the logic behind what I'm doing. The reason why I've given an example is because I want to make my word really, really clear about what I'm trying to put across as far as your component basis of accounting is concerned. And this is the major thing which revolves around the subsequent cost on a property, plant and equipment. So let's concentrate now. It was easier in the earlier illustration regarding component basis of subsequent recognition because I have clearly identified it as a separate component. Now, what if the replaced component was not identified earlier? Separately, earlier, what happens in such situation? When I have not identified the replacement or replaced component earlier separately, what happens? Since I told you that the carrying cost of B was 15, you could have easily solved the problem. But what if I don't know that B was there? I have replaced a particular component, but I don't know what is the carrying cost of that particular component because I have not identified it as a separate component earlier. In such situation, what we will do? Case number one. If original cost of the replaced component can be identified, if I can identify the original cost of the replaced component, then what should be the treatment? I have not identified it earlier, but I can identify. The original cost of the replaced component can be identified, but I did not do it earlier. Then in such situation, then charge to P&L should be to the extent of original cost reduced by less depreciation which can be allocated to the component. This I will charge to P&L, and instead I will capitalize the amount of replacement cost which I have incurred to replace that component which is worn out. That means I am saying, let's say B was not identified as a separate component earlier. Then in such cases, we have identified B along with another set of components together. Then in sense, what will be the value? So let's say, for example, like we are talking about the PPE, 100. Here I have identified only A and C. A includes B. And like we have said, C was about 30 rupees, while A now will have a cost of about 70 because it had 45 and 25 together now. This I have still identified as 5 years and this as 3 years. And this was depreciated close to 14 per year. We said it was 9 years, right? Sorry about that. I've taken it as 9 years. So 9 years, 70. The value will be about 9, 7, 63. About 7.7 or something like that. Or I can charge about 8 here. Here I can charge about 10 per annum. Now let's say, at the end of year 2, what will be the value now? At the end of year 2, A, which was 70 earlier, should be reduced by 7.7 into 2, 15.4 will be now available with a balance. This is A plus B together, will be available with a balance of about 54.6. While in the sense C, which was 30 earlier, will be reduced by about 20, available as 10. What did I replace? B is replaced for 40 rupees. In a sense, how do we do? If I can identify the original cost was 25, if I can identify this, minus attributed depreciation, how do you attribute depreciation to this? B was included with A and was allocated to P&L over 9 years. So here also attributed depreciation will be 25 into 2 by 9. 50 divided by 9, you will get something close to 5.5. That means the carrying cost of the component is, the carrying cost of the replaced component is 19.5. This I will charge to P&L. Well, how much will I capitalize? The replacement cost that is rupee 40 is capitalized. This is my treatment which I'll give. So this is how you are supposed to recognize it. And now if I want to identify the revised value of the asset, then A, which was 54.6, was reduced by 19.5. That means we will be identifying this with a value of 35.1 plus B 40 now plus C, which is 10. The total value of the asset will now become 85.1. This is how I'm going to recognize when the asset or when the component which is replaced cannot be was not identified earlier, but I know the original cost. What if the original cost also cannot be identified? You don't know what is the original cost of the component which got replaced also. In such sense, what we have to do and how is the accounting treatment being applied, that we'll have to see now. Yes guys, continuing from the component basis, now I'm saying that the original cost of the replaced component cannot be identified. I'm using the word cannot be identified now. I'll change this number to 2 now. Let's see what happens. This becomes really interesting now. The charge to P&L earlier was original cost minus depreciation allocated. But now I don't know what is original cost. So I will make sure that I will use the replacement cost itself and reduce it. This is how I'm going to do it. Very, very interesting concept, guys, this is. Because understand what we are trying to do here. When I don't know the original cost, I've deduced it. I'm making sure that I'm using the replacement cost itself. Like the example that we have taken where the PPE had a cost of about 100 and I'm allocating it only to two units, A and B. 70 and 30 having a life of 9 years and 3 years. And the depreciation to be charged, like I said, was 7.7 here per year. And this was about 10 rupees per year. If I develop from the same thing, this is C. Now the component B, which was already included in, includes B, this component A. So component B is replaced for about 40 rupees. I don't know what it is. I don't know what the original cost was. When I knew the original cost, I said original cost minus accumulated depreciation, what is attributed to it. But this replacement happened at the end of year 2. So today, I find that A and C like this. A had 70 minus 15.4, that is 54.6. And here, 30 minus 20, 10. This was the accumulated value, or this is the carrying value of the asset now. Now when B is replaced at 40 and I don't know the original cost, now I will say the charge to P&L should be equal to, take the replaced cost, 40 minus the amount of depreciation on this 40 should be reduced. The depreciation attributable to the component 40 is 40 into 2 by 9. Because 2 years is already done and I'm depreciating it for 9 years in the component. So I'm allocating the depreciation as 2 by 9. 80 divided by 9, we'll get a depreciation here to an extent of 8.9, whatever it is. Then we will get about 31.2. This 31.2 will be charged to P&L. Then what will I capitalize then? In such cases, what I will capitalize is 40. So my revised value after all this happens will have three components now, A, C and B. A earlier had 54.6, out of which 31.2 is derecognized. So 54.6 minus 31.2 should be coming up to about 23.4. While C has a value of about 10, which is still as it is, and B now has a replacement cost of 40. And this will sum up to about 73.4. This will be the cost, carrying cost of the asset after the replacement is undertaken. Three different approaches I've shown. One, where I know the original cost and I've identified it as a component. Two, I don't know, I haven't identified the component, but I know the cost. Three, I did not identify the component, I don't even know the cost. In such cases, how we do. So three different models or three different ways of identifying the carrying cost, and this is how you actually apply a component basis of accounting or recognition of property, plant and equipment. Very, very interesting and important concept to be included under Ind AS 16. Yes guys, so let's talk about subsequent recognition now of PPE. Subsequent measurement of property, plant and equipment. When it comes to subsequent measurement of property, plant and equipment as per Ind AS 16, Ind AS 16 has proposed two ways. There are two methods by which I can do subsequent measurement. The subsequent measurement can happen under two methods, the first one being called as cost model, second one being called as revaluation model. While under the cost model, we adopt cost minus accumulated depreciation minus accumulated impairment under revaluation model, we adopt cost or revalued amount. Here in this case, because it is revaluation, minus subsequent accumulated depreciation and impairment. These are two ways of which I can subsequently measure my property, plant and equipment. So when I use either a cost model or your revaluation model, the way of recognition happens like this. But however, what he has said was, you can apply these models, either of the models you can apply, but model applied should be consistent for all assets within a particular class. What is this model applied should be consistent for every particular class? That means I can adopt both the models for PPE. In an enterprise, I can adopt both, but making sure that for each class of asset, I should not apply different models. What are the class of assets? Land, building, plant and machinery, furniture, your equipments, your vehicles. These are different classes of assets. All assets within a particular class should follow the same model of subsequent measurement. You cannot have one furniture with which is measured at cost model, other furniture being measured at revaluation model. So within each class of assets, you have to follow the same model consistently. However, you can follow building as per revaluation method. You can follow land as per cost model. You can do this. This is allowed as per the act, as per your standard. Now, moving forward into this model, there's a small restriction which has been put up. This restriction is for revaluation model. The restriction put up for revaluation model is that you cannot apply revaluation model if the revaluation or the revalued amount or the fair value of a particular asset cannot be measured reliably. If the fair value of an asset cannot be measured reliably, Then the revaluation model cannot be applied. This is what we discuss. We are saying that if I cannot identify the fair value reliably, then I cannot apply the revaluation model, because revaluation predominantly depends on the fair value of the asset. If that fair value cannot be identified, then how can I even measure, or how can I recognize it as per fair value? Now, regularity of revaluation is what we have to understand. My regularity of revaluation, when I'm trying to explain, then I'm saying that if an asset has a fair value which changes frequently, then in such cases has to be done, then the revaluation should be done for each accounting period. I'll go on with regularity of revaluation. But however, if I'm talking about a fair value which does not change frequently, in such cases you can revalue every 3 to 5 years. Should not be a problem if you are doing it, revaluation of every 3 to 5 years. Now this is regularity of fair valuation, but I have a restriction saying that if you are making sure that the fair value can be identified reliably, only then the revaluation model can be applied. If you cannot identify, you have to adopt cost model only. And I also said that the regularity, if you are saying that the fair value changes very frequently, then we'll have to make sure that the revaluation is done for each accounting period. But if we have gone up and said that it is not frequently changing, then you can do a revaluation every 3 to 5 years. And I said, apply cost or revaluation model, there's no restriction. Only thing is, you have to apply it consistently to every class, every asset within a particular class. Got it? So two classes of assets within the same enterprise can adopt two different models of depreciation, one following cost model, other one following revaluation model. That should not be creating a problem. Got it? So yes guys, let's understand how the revaluation model works. When we're trying to understand the revaluation model, the simple logic behind that is identify the fair value of the property, plant and equipment at each measurement date and make sure that you are revaluing the asset to its fair value. Now, whenever this fair value identification comes up, you need to understand that the fair value measurement is dealt as per IND AS 113. There's a specific standard to deal with IND AS, the fair value measurement under the scope of IND AS. So the standard will specify how the fair value should be measured, and that is where we get the fair value from. Now, what we are talking about IND AS 16 is the treatment of such revaluation to our property, plant and equipment based on the fair value measurement. Now, when we try to revalue an asset, there are multiple revaluations which happen over the useful life of an asset. That means, if say the useful life of the asset is 5 years, during this 5 years period, I could do a multiple times revaluation to that particular asset. That's why we say that initial revaluation is one component and subsequent revaluation is the second one. We will have to identify, or we'll have to specify, what is the treatment under each such specific case. Now, so let's talk about initial and subsequent revaluation. We will talk about upward and downward first. Yeah, upward revaluation. And downward revaluation. under upward revaluation and downward revaluation, what we are talking about is initial revaluation, like I was talking about. The first time revaluation of an asset, and then the subsequent revaluation. Subsequently, when we revalue the asset, what we do? Under subsequent revaluation, again, there could be a situation where it was initially revalued upwards, or initially revalued downwards. Two situations which can arise. So I'm talking about initial revaluation, I'm talking about subsequent revaluation upward, and I'm talking about subsequent revaluation downward. Now let's see what is the accounting treatment which is given in each such case, upward revaluation and downward revaluation. First time when we are revaluing, that is the initial revaluation, and if such revaluation went upwards, then in such situation we will have to credit to revaluation surplus. You can call it as revaluation reserve as well, or you can call it as revaluation surplus. But if the initial revaluation was downwards, then we charge or debit to P&L. This is my initial revaluation concept. But when we are going about with the subsequent revaluation component, then under subsequent revaluation, if the initial revaluation was upwards, initially upwards, subsequently upwards, then no problem. I will simply credit to P&L again. Sorry, credit to revaluation reserve again. It was initially revalued upwards, subsequent revaluation again upwards, I'll credit to revaluation reserve. But initial revaluation was upward, then subsequently if it went downwards, then debit the revaluation reserve to the extent available, but if your downward revaluation sometimes is more than the revaluation which happened upwards earlier, 100 rupee asset was initially revalued upwards by 20, but subsequently was downward revaluation by 30, then in such case your debit to revaluation surplus is not sufficient, because you had only a revaluation reserve of 20 there. What should I do with the balance 10 then? Balance, if any, such amount I will debit to P&L. Such amount, if I have any, then I will debit it to P&L. But now look at this. This is a downward revaluation, initially downward revalued, subsequently upward revalued. Initially, when you did downward revaluation, you debited it to P&L. Now you are subsequently revaluing upwards. So credit the P&L to the extent it was debited earlier. If I have balance, then credit to revaluation reserve. While this is very simple, initially downwards, subsequently also downwards, then I'll simply debit to P&L. No further treatment. This is how the treatment should happen whenever there is an upward and a downward revaluation of a property, plant and equipment, when you are applying a revaluation model for a property, plant and equipment. Now, whenever you are continuing and seeing all these accounting treatments that have come up, now comes the concept of how do I use this revaluation surplus. I have created a revaluation reserve at multiple situations. This was one case, and then we had again credited it to revaluation reserve, then again we had a revaluation reserve which is coming up. So multiple places I have been using the revaluation reserve, then the concept should start looking at utilization of revaluation reserve.
Now, there are multiple guidance notes on revaluation reserve utilization,
but I'll put in short what each guidance note has to talk about. One such guidance note, which is talking about utilization of revaluation surplus, says that this revaluation surplus is perfectly a non-cash reserve. Since it is a non-cash reserve, then it is not available for distribution either as dividends or for bonus shares. You cannot utilize this amount of revaluation reserve for the amount of dividends or for the purpose of bonus. Then how do I use it? You are saying about restrictions of use. I'm talking about how do I use it. There should be a possible way of using a reserve. Every reserve should be utilized. If I can't use a reserve, then what is the point of even indicating such reserve? So that's why he says revaluation reserve can be used. The utilization says that revaluation reserve should be credited to P&L. P&L here in the sense should be OCI. I will talk about this item. To the extent of excess depreciation charged on PPE. Each year. Now what we are saying is revaluation reserve will only appear when the asset is revalued upward. When your asset is revalued upward, the amount of depreciation that will be charged on such asset will also be higher. The amount of excess depreciation which is there should be credited to P&L. OCI is also an item within the P&L. We will talk about this OCI item when we are talking about Ind AS 1. Until then, understand that OCI is simply a part of your P&L and nothing else. Got it? So this is simply my accounting treatment which has been proposed under a guidance note for utilization of revaluation reserve. Yes guys, so to cite an example for this, let's say for example the cost of asset was 100. It was initially upward revalued by 20, became 120. If the useful life of the asset is, let's say, about 5 years, then the amount of depreciation to be charged per annum should be 20 and 24 in this case. See, now look at what is the treatment which I'm talking about. I'm saying that this 20 is anyways going into the word called as revaluation reserve. It is going into the head of revaluation reserve without any doubt. But now I'm saying there is an increase of 4 rupees which is arising because of this revaluation here. This amount is what we are talking at as, we are terming it as excess depreciation. So what are we saying? To the extent of this 4, initially when we have upward revalued the asset, I would have written the accounting entry as PPE account debit to revaluation reserve. To the extent of that 20 rupees. When I charge depreciation, I am saying that I will record the depreciation entry like this. I will charge it to P&L, P&L account debit 24 now after revaluation to depreciation. The first entry should have been depreciation to P&L. Sorry, depreciation to asset, P&L to depreciation. Now I am saying to give the counter effect for that, I will reduce the amount of revaluation reserve.
revaluation reserve account debit to the extent of that 4 to P&L. Like I told you, it is OCI actually, 4.
This is my set of accounting entries which I record. Understand, ultimately the impact on P&L is nullified even though the revaluation does occur, because you are anyways crediting out of revaluation reserve to your P&L. So the P&L, if you observe, 24 got debited and 4 got credited, ultimately comes back to the same figure of 20. Think about revaluation surplus, you have 20. Each year, if I'm crediting the P&L by 4, over 5 years period, that is a remaining useful life, I will complete the entire 20 credit to P&L if the asset is not subsequently revalued again. Got it? So this is my simple accounting treatment that we propose when we are talking about utilization of revaluation surplus. Right? Yes, guys. So let's talk about the next concept in property, plant and equipment, that is depreciation. Like we said in subsequent measurement, an asset should always be measured subsequently at the cost minus accumulated amount of depreciation. So we are concentrating upon this concept called as depreciation here. And how do we recognize this depreciation in our books, and how do I measure the amount of depreciation? Your measurement of depreciation is predominantly governed under the guidance note. On depreciation as per Schedule 2 of Companies Act. This is the guidance note which predominantly affects the depreciation computation under any company. But we still have extract from the standard. We will talk about the standard, then we'll later talk about the guidance note. What the depreciation we have learned is there are multiple methods of depreciating a particular asset. You can go even as per a straight line method. You can do a WDV method. You can do multiple models of depreciation which can be applied to any property, plant and equipment. However, there is no specific method prescribed in the standard. The standard does not prescribe any particular method. It never used the word SLM, it never used the word WDV, nothing. No machine hour rate, no piecemeal basis, nothing. We're just saying that there is no method which is appropriate. Then how do I charge the amount of depreciation then, when I don't even know what method should I apply? Then he said, depreciation on a property, plant and equipment should represent a pattern in which economic benefits are expected to arise. From the use of the asset, see what he is talking about. Depreciation on a property, plant and equipment, I am not specifying a method, but I am telling you that you have to ensure that it should represent a pattern, the pattern in which economic benefits are expected to arise from the use of an asset. How do I even identify this? Now understand, it is not that subjective also, saying that, you know, he has left enough scope. He did not leave enough scope. Understand. Let's say, for example, I'm commencing operations with a new machinery. Such new machinery, let's say, has a production capacity of about 10,000 units per day. That is the capacity that it has. Day one onwards, I can't really start using the entire 10,000 units. Reason being, even if I produce the 10,000 units, there should be a consumption to the extent of 10,000 units. I need to have the demand. I do not have so much of demand. Initially, what do we do as a business plan? We first generate some certain samples. We make sure that the samples are distributed at multiple places. And once I get some good response for the samples, then I start doing my production based on the amount of orders which I got. Now, if you assess this entire situation out, what we will try to understand, or what we understand, is that the depreciation on that particular asset will depend on the pattern of utilization. Look at this machinery and what is the pattern of utilization. Initially, obviously, the number of orders will be low because I've just commenced the operation with the new machine. So initially, when it is low, I will charge lower amount of depreciation. As years pass by, the amount of consumption keeps on increasing. First year, my production utilization was 30%. Second year, it has jumped to 50. Third year, it has jumped to 80. From fourth, fifth, and sixth onwards, I'm getting 100. And somewhere towards the end of its useful life of the asset, it keeps on falling down again. So what we understand from this, my basic depreciation pattern is basically looking like a curve, because it initially moves upward and then it stagnates at a point of time and then slowly moves downward. That is a pattern of depreciation on a machine which is newly purchased. But let's say I'm talking about a vehicle. Observe how different the depreciation pattern would be for a vehicle, because initially, when I see a vehicle, be it my bike or a car, the first few months, you know, you get the feel where it is a new car or a new bike. We start showing it off. The amount of benefit which I'm getting it when it is new is much higher. As years progress, what happens? First year, I'll start cleaning it daily. Second year, automatically, I'll start cleaning it once a week. Third year onwards, I'll be cleaning it once a month. Fourth year onwards, no cleaning. Only monsoon time, if there is a rainfall, automatically it gets cleaned up. So this is a pattern in which I'm utilizing it. So observe the pattern of getting the economic benefit high at the beginning, slowly keeps falling down steeply towards the end, and where it becomes zero. The zero is a point where you ask your dad or mom saying that, you know, I need a new bike. That is zero, because the economic benefit is not there what you have to derive from that particular bike. Or I would say that at least it is very minimum. So this is basically the pattern of utilization which I'm talking about. The pattern of utilization is what we have to observe in the economic benefit, and your depreciation should follow the same pattern. Got it? So this is basically what we talk about in depreciation. Remember, guys, sometimes we have this confusion saying that if fair value of an asset, PPE, exceeds the carrying amount, should I continue to depreciate or not? That is question number one. Question number two, if the carrying value of asset carrying value of property, plant and equipment falls lower than the residual value, or instead we call it a scrap value, which is expected to realize at the end of its useful life, then whether I have to depreciate or not. These are two very, very critical events which I have to examine when I'm talking about depreciation. When I look at the first case, fair value significantly higher than carrying amount, in such situations, we will continue to depreciate. That means you cannot say that I will not depreciate an asset because my fair value is higher. If such is your stance, then make sure that you are adopting a revaluation model, not a cost-based model. But when your carrying value slips lower than the residual value, that means residual value is a value that you will realize at the end of a useful life of an asset. Carrying value is falling shorter than that, or I can say equal to that. Then in such cases, depreciation should cease. This is what we can talk about in these two events, two peculiar situations which I have picked up, and I'm just giving an explanation of what should be done to the extent of depreciation in both such events. Fair value exceeds the carrying amount, then what I should do? Carrying amount is falling lower than the value of residual value which it will realize at the end of its useful life, then what I have to do? Fair value exceeds carrying value, depreciation should not stop, it should keep continuing. But if your carrying amount is falling lower than the amount of the residual value, you have to stop depreciation. There's no further depreciation which is necessary to be charged. Now, no depreciation will be charged for assets which are discharged from active use. That means I'm no longer using the asset, then no longer charge the depreciation towards that. Why is this happening? Maybe the technology has changed in such a way that the previous asset is not worth using it, or the capacity utilization of the asset is already completed, the useful life is already over. In such events, you might come across the situation where it is discharged from active use. That means you are abandoning the asset from active use. In such situation, it will be covered as per IND AS 105. At the beginning of the standard, I told you this is an exclusion. Where a non-current asset is held for sale, in such events, it should not be covered under IND AS 16. Instead, it should be covered under IND AS 105. Once an asset starts discharged from active use or abandoned from active use, in such situation, I will classify the asset as non-current asset held for sale and recognize and measure as per IND AS 105. IND AS 16 has nothing to do with it. This is in practical application what we start looking at. Like I told you, there could be a cost model, revaluation model, even if the fair value is more, continue to depreciate. Now, all this concept I told you, but understand, first of all, depreciation is dependent upon the cost. What if I wanted to change from the cost model to the revaluation model, then what happens? What if I wanted to change from revaluation to cost model, what happens? What if I wanted to increase the cost of the particular asset? What if I change the useful life of the asset? Initially, I thought it will be used for 4 years. Now I'm saying that it could be used for 6 years. Now all these situations have to be dealt with under depreciation itself. Yes, guys. So let's start looking at depreciation. We have already dealt with depreciation, but let me talk further into it. What is a depreciable value? To determine depreciable value of a property, plant and equipment, we'll write it like this. Depreciable value is equal to cost of asset PPE less its estimated residual value. This can be called as depreciable value of an asset. When we are looking at this depreciable value of an asset, understand, we'll have to understand that this depreciable value, what we have identified out here, has to be charged to P&L over the expected useful life of asset. From this, what we understand is that depreciation is predominantly based on three factors. The three factors which I determine my depreciation is the cost, my residual value, and the useful life of asset. These are three determinants of depreciation we can record. Depreciation on a property, plant and equipment will depend on these three items. Number one, cost of asset. Number two, estimated useful life of asset. Number three, estimated residual value, the value that you would realize at the end of the useful life of the asset from sale of such asset, when you dispose that asset. these three are predominantly called as determinants of depreciation. Now, always understand that there could be a change in the cost, could be a change in estimated useful life, could be a change in estimated residual value, either upwards or downwards. So whenever there is a change in determinants of depreciation, in such case where there's a change in determinants of depreciation, always remember that we will only give a prospective effect. Only a prospective effect. What is this prospective effect? This prospective effect means it should only affect the depreciation of future periods and should not be affecting the depreciation which has already been charged to P&L. Depreciation of future periods should be based on the revised cost, residual value, and estimated useful life. We are not going to change the depreciation which has ever been already charged to P&L in the previous accounting periods. That is what we mean by saying prospective effect. But we'll also have to look at the other dimension, that is what happens when there is a change in method of depreciation. What is this change in method of depreciation means? From cost model, you have moved to revaluation model. From revaluation, you have moved to cost model. This change in method of depreciation is called as change in accounting estimates. Has to be dealt with as per IND AS 8. And according to the standard, what they say is, only a prospective effect should be given. Again, I'm saying prospective effect, I've already explained. Depreciation of future period should be based on the revised cost, residual value, and useful life. So the depreciation which was already charged to P&L in the previous accounting periods should not be affected whenever there's a change in the method of depreciation or there is a change in determinants of depreciation. Both the cases, what is proposed is only the prospective effect. Clear?